Dear learners, this short audio-visual lecture intends to acquaint you with an important neoclassical satire by the Restoration writer John Dryden called Absalom and Achitophel. Absalom and Achitophel is a landmark political satire by Dryden, although he chose to call it a poem rather than a satire, implying thereby that it had elements other than purely satirical. One cannot, for instance, overlook the obvious epic or heroic touches in it. Critics have unanimously remarked on Dryden's capacity to transform the trivial into the poetical and change personal envy into the fury of imaginative creation. Now, even if Dryden denies that it is a mere political satire, we have to look at the political background in which the poem was composed in order to delve into the other features of the poem in this lecture and in future lectures related to the same poem. The poem originated in the political situation of England in the 1680s, and one cannot fail to note that several political personalities are satirized in this poem. Published in November 1681, the theme of the poem was suggested by the restored King Charles II himself to Dryden, who was then the poet laureate. At this time, the question of the succession to King Charles had assumed great importance in England. The Earl of Shaftesbury, who was Anthony Ashley Cooper, had been thrown into prison to face a charge of high treason. There were two contenders for the throne of England because Charles II did not have a legitimate heir. The two contenders for the succession were, firstly, Charles's brother James, Duke of York, who was a Roman Catholic, and the other contender was Charles's illegitimate son, James Scott, Duke of Monmouth, who was a Protestant and hugely popular among the masses. The Whigs were supporting Monmouth, who was immensely popular, and also because they regarded James with suspicion because of his Roman Catholic underpinnings. The Tories were, however, supporting the cause of James and the King in order to ensure stability in the country and also perpetuate the royal line. There was great public unrest on account of the uncertainty of succession and also the complicity in what came to be known as the exclusion crisis. King Charles II saw to it that the exclusion bill brought before the Parliament in order to exclude the succession of his brother could not be pushed through. He devoted his entire attention to stopping this from happening. The Earl of Shaftesbury, a highly ambitious man who was also the leader of the Whigs, sought to capitalize on this unrest, and for this purpose he started inciting Monmouth to rebel against his father, convincing him that the entire population of England was with him. The king, though extremely fond of this illegitimate child, did not approve of his succession because that would have been against the law and the divine right of kings. The Earl of Shaftesbury was eventually arrested on a charge of high treason and lost popular support. The day was finally saved for the king as he had his way and James became the King of England, but much of the credit of this does go to Dryden's deft prophecy, which warned the public of England in Absalom and Achitophel. Now, we must try to understand what were the aims of Dryden in composing this poem. The aim of Dryden was to support the king and to expose his enemies, to uphold the royalist cause as just. Charles had his own weaknesses. He was extremely fond of women, but Dryden seems to put a charitable mantle over his sexual sins. He is mild in dealing with his real vices, and the king himself did not think unfavorably of his love affairs. Sexual license was the order of the age, and as such, it did not deserve condemnation. Now, what were the aims of Dryden while he was composing Absalom and Achitophel? The aim was to support the king and to expose his enemies, to uphold the royalist cause as just. But this was not an easy proposition. because Charles II had his own weaknesses. He was extremely fond of women. But Dryden tries to put a charitable mantle over his sexual sins. He's mild in dealing with his real vices, and the king himself did not think unfavorably of his numerous love affairs, because sexual license was the order of the age, and as such, it did not deserve condemnation. If you remember your reading of the Restoration Age from your undergraduate times, you will remember, especially in the depiction of the age in the comedies, in the Restoration Comedy of Manners, the upper class rakes, who are the aristocrats, they are projected as happy-go-lucky in their numerous love affairs, and the butt of all the jokes in the drama are the middle classes with their rigid moral paraphernalia. So that is what is applicable for the entire society of the times. Dryden has nothing but praise for the king's moderation in political matters and his leniency towards rebels. Dryden's lash falls on the king's enemies, and especially the Earl of Shaftesbury, who was the main instigator in this entire episode. He is projected as a reckless politician without any moral scruples, who, having tried in vain eventually to seduce Charles towards arbitrary government, had now turned around and joined the other party and was trying to rouse the public against the king. Dryden dreads the fickleness of the mob, and he is not sure to what extremes a crowd which has been misled can go. However, the king's strictness and the instinct for the rule of law won for him popular support, and he was able to determine the succession according to his desire. Dryden's reference to the godlike David shows his flattery of the king and his belief in the divine right theory of kings. Dryden was both poet laureate at this time as well as royal historiographer. The dual duties must have made his position as composer of Absalom and Achitophel extremely difficult. So it is difficult to analyze how true he was to the characteristics of Charles or how true he was in condemning the Whigs. However, what makes the poem extremely interesting is the way in which he tries to handle the situation in a kind of balanced attitude. In order to handle this delicate business of composing Absalom and Achitophel, he used a very popular technique, that of the biblical allegory. Now, the biblical story of Absalom revolting against his father David, king of Israel, from the Old Testament, second book of Samuel, in order to satirize the contemporary political situation. The choice of a biblical allegory by Dryden is nothing novel, because it had been used with much effect and much popularity before him by John Bunyan in his famous Pilgrim's Progress. But his general treatment of the subject in Absalom and Achitophel is beyond comparison. But all the while, Dryden takes care to see that the political satire is not lost in the confusion of a too intricate biblical parallelism. The advantage of setting the story in pre-Christian times is obvious, as it gave Dryden the chance to shield the king's vices and satirize the king's opponents without endangering his own position. To discredit the opponents, he had to emphasize on Monmouth's illegitimacy, but at the very same time, he had to see that Charles, who was Monmouth's father and the cause of that illegitimacy, was not adversely affected by his criticism. He could not openly condone Charles's loose morals. At the same time, he could not openly criticize it either. With a masterly touch, thus he sets the poem in the mold of a biblical allegory, setting the entire political situation as a parallel in times which are before the time of monogamy, using the story of Absalom's revolt against his father David, king of Israel, and he tries to make the situation suitably distance historically, and yet is able to add a universal warning for populist politics. There were several challenges which Dryden faced while composing Absalom and Achitophel. Dryden is correctly regarded as the most vigorous and polished of English satirists, combining refinement with fervor. He is unequaled in debating in rhyme, and Absalom and Achitophel displays his power of arguing in verse. It may be said that Absalom and Achitophel has no rival in the field of political satire. Apart from the contemporary interest of the poem and its historical value, its appeal to the modern reader lies in its observations on English character and on the weaknesses of mankind in general. His generalizations on human nature have a perennial interest. Dryden triumphed over the peculiar difficulties of his chosen theme. He had to give not abuse or politics, but the poetry of abuse and politics. He had to criticize a son whom the father still loved. He had to make Shaftesbury denounce the king, but he had to see to it that the king was not offended by those denunciations. He had to praise without sounding servile, and he had to criticize artistically. Dryden achieves all this cleverly and skillfully. Achitophel's denunciation of the king assumes the shade of a eulogy in the eyes of Charles. Absalom is not criticized harshly, rather he is projected as a misguided instrument in the hands of the evil Achitophel. The poem is certainly a political satire, but it is a blend of dignity with incisive and effective satire. The dialogic structure of Veronian satire permits Dryden to negotiate all sides of the argument. A crucial skill for any public writer when the nature of power and law and where they are seated, whether in parliament, whether in the king, whether in the people or in the poet himself, are all at stake. Major readings of Absalom and Achitophel analyze, among much else, what can be termed the directionality of the poem. That is, they situate the purpose of its satire, the amendment of vices by correction, as generally directed towards the people or as generally directed towards the king. The poem, of course, seems to move in both directions, from a court perspective and a public one, a strategy immediately apparent in the rhetoric of the impartiality deliberately emphasized in the preface to Absalom and Achitophel. Dryden pretends from the outset to even-handedness in his treatment of the issues addressed. The preface is a preemptive defense on behalf of a moderate political stance, noting the possibility of merits on each sides of the Whigs and the Tories, Puritan and the Papist. Now, Stephen Zwicker, an important critic who wrote Politics and Language in Dryden's Poetry, calls this the rhetoric of what could be termed the middle way. Now, Dryden's poem, as mentioned earlier, is a Veronian or a Menippean satire. Unlike Dryden's earlier satires, verging on lampoonery as Macfleckno, where the barb of his satire is directed at Shadwell's physical deformities and personal traits, Absalom and Achitophel directs its invective towards populist politics and such leaders as a direct threat to the stability and continuity of English society and civilization. The main thrill of the poem lies on the deft characterization of the opponents of the king, which Dryden paints with caustic humor. One example is the character of Zimri, or the Duke of Buckingham. Let us read the descriptions of Zimri. In the first rank of these did Zimri stand, a man so various that he seemed to be not one, but all mankind's epitome. Stiff in opinions, always in the wrong, was everything by starts and nothing long. But in the course of one revolving moon, was chemist, fiddler, statesman, and buffoon. Then all for women, painting, rhyming, drinking, besides 10,000 freaks that died in thinking. Blessed madman, who could every hour employ with something new to wish or to enjoy. Thus, making his readers aware that the rabble-rousers like Buckingham, in their fickleness and vacillations, posed a greater threat to the stability of the English civilization than a Roman Catholic monarch. Absalom and Achitophel thus remains a universal warning against anarchy and misrule. Thank you.